Thank you. Yep. And that concludes today's lecture. Okay. I like next week better. I think I'll come back. So what I'd like to do, if you'll indulge me a little bit, is get to know you all a little bit better. So there's a lot of people here, but what I wanted to do is just go around, maybe even randomly per table, and if we have time, kind of get to know who you are. And the way I'd like to do that, if you would, again, indulge me, is just by knowing your first name and kind of what you do relative to work-wise, if you work with addictions or a therapist or a nurse or in the medical field, etc. And if you like, just one sentence of what you'd like to get out of this experience today. So just name what you do and maybe a sentence about what you'd like to get out of today. So how about if we go with this table, since I'm so close?
Well, all right, so we've got a start.
We have a winner.
Good morning, I'm Charlie Martino. I'm with Riverside Choose Home, the Center for Excellence in Aging. I'm a gerontologist, work with older adults, and love to get out of this program understanding a little bit more of eating disorders that would help us with our clients.
Perfect, thank you.
I'm Jean Garrison, and I am a CASA, or court-appointed special advocate for kids that are abused and neglected, and I hope to learn a little bit more about the eating disorder.
Thank you. And I'm also a CASA. I have a client that has issues, and I'd like to know that. To be a story,
great.
I'm Kendria Pierce. I have I'm an outpatient therapist working with children, adolescents, adults, and I'm here too for a better understanding of eating disorders. I don't have too many folks with that, but it's come up a lot, so I just want to
get some. We'll go to this table.
I'm Marilyn. I'm a market coder at Pavilion, and I'd like to know the difference with older adults.
Okay.
I'm Diana.
Come in my email so I can make it here, because food addiction I have found is very prevalent with recovery, especially from other substances.
Right, switching chairs on the Titanic, okay?
And so I'm just really, really curious how this can better help my clients.
My name is Marcia. I'm in private practice. I tend to specialize in addictions, eating disorders, and women's issues. I know they all go together.
Yeah.
I
can get whatever information I can get.
Great.
My name is Nancy. I'm a retired clinical social worker, and to be on my CEUs in case I go back to work. But this is a particular subject of interest.
Okay. My name is Pius Akuno. I work in mental challenge at Charles Waterhouse, and I'm interested to see how the subject condition can go.
My name is Sister Mary, and I'm a registered nurse. I'm working with mentally challenged adults. And they know this is a problem to them, so I'm excited to know more about it be able to use it to help those are walking.
Okay, so we'll do two more tables. How about this?
Well, rather than take up all the time going around, is there anybody else who would like to introduce themselves? Don't all rush into it. Okay. So let me just poll something. How many of you work in something related to the addictions field and or have some familiarity with addictions treatment or 12-step oriented support groups? That's good. Okay. All right, so let me just preface all of this by giving you a little disclaimer. And the disclaimer is that there's kind of two parts to my experiences working with eating disorders. One part has nothing to do with the letters after my name. It has to do with my, you know, my personal history. And the other has to do with the academic and research and clinical side of me. So they kind of merge together. I don't always know how to tease them out, but I say that because some of this is anecdotal and some of this is evidence-based, and when we get into the realm of treatment, most of what you're going to hear is evidence-based and a little bit of personal experiences with that. So hopefully I will pique your interest with all this. So I always like to start off with this quote. It's one of the better quotes that I'm familiar with. It's Arthur Schopenhauer. All truth passes through three stages. First, it's ridiculed. Second, it's violently opposed. Third, it's accepted as self-evident. And if you look out, you know, through the whole history of medicine, there have been things, assumptions that were made that were just taken as truth. If you look at surgery, I know there's a med-surg nurse here. It used to be that if you proposed that you should wash your hands or wear gloves, that that was preposterous at one time. It was also proposed that if you had a heart attack, the best thing you could do is lie in bed for 6 months. It was also proposed that if you had any kind of disease or malady, that using leeches to suck blood out of you would be a good remedy. So a lot of what is taken for granted, and then a lot of new ideas are usually met along this kind of sequence of things. And I'll just use one more parallel because I find it relevant, at least in my lifetime, and that is there was a time when you smoked on airplanes and in restaurants and whatnot, and in the early 60s and mid-60s, I've been told. thank you. The idea that smoking caused lung cancer, was deleterious, was just coming into focus. And I have, I don't know if anybody's ever done this, but I have like a book from like Life magazine of the year I was born, which was right after Lincoln was shot. Anyway, there are ads in there with physicians in lab coats touting the benefits of smoking Tarentins and Winstons and whatnot. I know we're in Virginia, but I just throw this out to you. So what, nothing stays the same. So when we get into this realm of the semantics of food addiction, don't get misled by the semantics, because it's like drug addiction. Not all drugs are addictive and not all food's addictive. I mean, you know, when you say drugs, well, is aspirin a drug, right? So don't get caught up in the semantics. That's all I'm really trying to say. So keep an open mind and we'll see where it goes. I love his hairdo. I love his hairdo and his mustache. So here's my basic assumption. Addiction in general, it's a complex combination of interactions between the biology of the addict, the nature of the substance abused, and the environment these takes place. So let me distill this to something very simple. To me, addiction is a generic term. I know that the American Psychiatric Association, in all of its wisdom, has taken out the notion that there's such a thing as addiction, and now we have substance use disorder, and then we have different categories of severity and so on and so forth. But the fact of the matter is this, that addiction is an interaction in my experience, personally, professionally, and research-wise. There's the nature of the substance, and there's the nature of the person, and then there's the setting or the environment. That's the perfect storm. So you can have a substance that's very addictive, but if the nature of the person isn't an addict, they can become physically dependent on something, but not in my realm become an addict. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. You can take two people, and they can both have surgery, and they can both be on a morphine pump. Okay, let me think about that one for a while. And what will happen is the person who is the non-addict will become physically dependent on the morphine, but will want nothing to do with it once they're taken off the pump. They may go through some physical withdrawal, and they'll meet the criterion for addiction in terms of withdrawal, but it's a discontinuation syndrome. The addict, anybody want to take a guess, will go through the same physical withdrawal, but what's the delineation between the two? Craving. The addict will want more, the non-addict will want no part of it. So when we talk about addiction in its generic sense, we're looking at the properties of the substance or the behavior, but also the nature of the person and the setting or the circumstances it takes place. I think that that's important to kind of lay the groundwork with. So I would suspect all of you are familiar with this, or most of you are, but I'm just going to go through it real quickly. This is the DSM-5 newer criteria for addiction. So basically what they're saying is tolerance, we all know, is you need more of the same substance or to do more of the same behavior to get the same effect. So one pill of Percocet, for instance, for pain will become two, will become three, become four, because over time, frequency, duration, intensity will diminish, and so you have to have more to get the same effect. Do you think that could happen with food? Okay. Withdrawal symptoms. As I said, withdrawal symptoms can be very dramatic, sort of like heroin withdrawal, or someone's diaphoretic and they're convulsing or what. But really, withdrawal has two features to it. One is physical, but there's also psychological withdrawal. And to me, psychological withdrawal is more protracted. It can last a lifetime, a week, a month, a year, whatever. But it's usually marked by feeling more uncomfortable without the drug or substance or behavior than with it. So it's kind of self-explanatory. How about using more for longer periods than intended? Unsuccessful effort to cut back. Anybody ever diet here? Significant time to obtain or recover from effects. Giving up social, occupational, recreational activities, AKA isolation. Continued despite consequences. Here's the deal. When these guys got together in the task force to come up with this idea, they did two things. They put level of dependency. So if you got 2 out of 3, you get a consolation prize of having mild substance use disorder. Moderate 4 to 5, you know, and then severe 6+. They never were considering any kind of process addiction or substance addiction that had to do with food or eating. The closest they came to was gambling. So they didn't think of sex as being addictive or shopping being addictive or food. That's what they were thinking of. However, as we go along, what you'll find is that, at least in the population I treat that's at the residential level of care, they meet 7 out of 7 of these criteria, almost without exception. To me, the relationship or the pathological relationship with food and body image is much more difficult to navigate and deal with than it is with the black and white issues around alcohol or drugs. That's just how I experience it. And most people will have cross addictions, which we'll talk about. So basically, here's where I'm at. Most treatment, when you translate all this, by the way, the most important question I learned, at least when I was in school, was to always ask after you figure all this stuff out and connect the dots is, so what, now what? Keeping that in mind, what's happened with the research and what's happened with treatment is it's usually in two flavors. The majority of people that treat eating disorders do not recognize it as an addiction, whether it's flavored as anorexia, restricting, underweight, bulimia, binging, purging, binge eating disorder, compulsive overeating, call it what you want. They treat it more as a traditional psychiatric issue, the assumption being that if you connect the dots or work through whatever that means, and have some insight as to why you are engaged in this, that somehow will have a therapeutic or curative effect. Traditional psychotherapy does not work in my professional and personal experience with people with addictions in general or eating disorders. It is a great ancillary approach when you're tweaking beyond the addictive relationship with the food or the body image and dealing with other issues that are common to people with addictions in recovery, but it is not an effective tool to get someone to stop. So that's the controversy. I tend to look at it as a combination of two issues, just like there would be with alcohol or drug addiction. There's an emotional component, for sure, but there's also a physical component. And I'll say spiritual component, but I'll just say sense of identity or purpose, however you want to define that, because that's always an ambiguous term to define, but we'll leave it at that. So basically, it's not just biological, it's not just emotional, it's a mixture of both. Okay? We'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. So like I said, drug addiction is more semantics. Not all drugs are addictive. And not all food, if you use the term food addiction, not all foods are addictive. So when you get into the nature of the substance component, you have to be careful because you have to be specific as to what substance is. So this is something called the Food Addiction Institute, but it's a great quote, I think. From their standpoint, remember, all or none, feast or famine, their whole thing is biological. Other people might be all emotional. But from the biological perspective, this is their take on it. It's basically a disease like like substance abuse, where it's a cluster of chemical dependencies on specific foods. And the majority of people that have a compulsive overeating or overconsuming component to their eating disorder, bulimia, some forms of anorexia, certainly binge eating, etc., the overwhelming majority of foods that they're sensitive to are high glycemic foods or highly processed foods. So if you ask me to paint with a broad brush and say, well, what substances in the food realm are addictive, I would say chances are if it's highly processed, it has addictive components to it. If you got me to narrow it down, I would say sugar, white flour. And then if you got even further, for some people, they may be sensitive to wheat or grains and things of that sort. But you can get so exhausted with the list that you're left with a knife and a fork and one grain of brown rice. I mean, that gets a little into another form of eating disorder or perfectionism or something called orthorexia. Anyway, so food addiction, nature of the substance. Let's just make this real simple. Highly processed foods, high glycemic, sugar, flour. Okay? So I just want to give you an appreciation of the dynamics of pathological eating or the regulation of appetite. And I'm going to go through this kind of quickly because we could spend 3 days on all of this. But basically, when you look at what governs eating, you're really looking at a whole list of things. And for some people, more of one of these components than another. But when you look at pathological eating, I'm going to tell you that most of it revolves around the substance piece and the emotional piece. It's not, so you could be, like with alcoholism, you can have 10% of it being genetic and physiological. When I start to drink, I can't stop kind of a thing. And some of it being emotional or learned response, like a binge drinker or something of that sort. I don't know that it really matters. However, you can't say it's one or the other, it's a combination. So genetics. So is there a gene that contributes to or causes someone to become a compulsive overeater, a binge eater? By the way, let me back up a step. There's a difference between a weight disorder and an eating disorder. There's a difference between a heavy social drinker and an alcoholic, right? So the difference has to do with the craving piece, the choice piece, and some of the other pieces along here. So not everybody that has an eating disorder has a weight disorder, and not everybody with a weight disorder has an eating disorder. Here's the question. Can you be someone that's a binge eater or compulsive overeater or food addict and not have an issue with being overweight? Yes. Not all compulsive overeaters are overweight, and vice versa. So weight is a very poor indicator or diagnostic tool to look at an eating disorder. Okay, back to this. Genetics. 20% of the population has a predisposition towards a weight disorder, and within that, about half or 10% an eating disorder. The weight disorder, eating disorder, genetic load has more to do with something called leptin. Anybody ever hear of leptin? Good. Okay. Leptin and ghrelin are two hormones in the body. Leptin is in fat tissue or adipose tissue, and it's the brakes. Easiest way for me to explain it. Leptin tells you, and your insulin level and all of that stuff, leptin tells you when to stop eating, when you've had enough. It's a satiety hormone. It sends a message up to the brain, blah, 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 and it tells you you've had enough. Okay? Leptin, the brakes. Ghrelin is made in the stomach primarily. It's the gas pedal. It's what tells you internally it's time to eat or you need to eat. So that's the gas pedal. There are some people that are born with, about 20%, with a deficit, not in the amount of leptin that they have, but what I would call like type 1 diabetes, where they're born with enough leptin, but it doesn't work. The brakes are faulty. And so what ends up happening is there is no adequate system for satiety. So that person will continue to eat, will continue to dump insulin, and have a predisposition towards the symptom of obesity, but certainly manifest a pattern of either grazing, compulsive overeating, binge eating, what have you. However, there's a more pronounced issue here that I'm just going to deviate to, and that's called leptin resistance. We've just found that out in the last couple of years. Leptin resistance means, like insulin, like type 2 diabetes. If you're overeating, eventually what will end up happening is that the leptin won't work as effectively. You build a tolerance to it. So what's happening is you are gaining weight. There's more leptin being produced because you have more adipose tissue. But what's happening is you have leptin resistance. So you're dumping leptin, but the brakes are faulty. You need new brake pads. So you continue to eat, so it's adding insult to injury. It's the same thing as insulin resistance. So I don't want to confuse you with all that. Okay, reward circuits. This is real important. How many of you are familiar with dopamine and reward circuits and the whole idea with looking at this with addiction? Okay, so basically there are three neurochemicals in the body that play a starring role in how we feel, moods, whether we feel good, bad, et cetera, et cetera. Dopamine, serotonin, and norepinephrine. The leading role, the star in the story of addiction is dopamine. And what we've identified is something called D2 or dopamine receptors. So dopamine receptors are responsible for taking in a chemical called dopamine, which usually makes us feel good. It's the feel-good chemical. If someone does a line of cocaine, what ends up happening is that they're getting a spritz, like a garden hose that's really on, full on, an explosion of dopamine. And what ends up happening is they get high, right? You know, they may run around this campus selling matchbook covers, for all I know, but they're feeling good. Amphetamines, diet pills will cause that. Opiates, believe it or not, will cause that. Anything that will get you high will create a reward circuit. Okay. And of course, with reward circuits, what's happening if you're using it or abusing it? You build tolerance and go through that whole mechanism. So what we found out is that that basically there are two types of people. One type, remember the person that acquires dependency, and one that has the nature of the person. So the best way I can explain this is now I'll go into a little personal thing. I grew up with someone named Harry. Some of you may have grown up with someone named Harriet. It really doesn't matter. Harriet is the person, for me, that I would like to see die slowly and painfully in front of my eyes. He's the guy who would order a hamburger, French fries, and a cherry Coke at the town diner, Cedarhurst, New York, when I was in junior high school. And he would leave over 4 bites of his hamburger, half his French fries, and I would be thinking to myself, because I was sitting in front of a diet plate, which is a hamburger patty that looks like it was stepped on by a rhinoceros. Wilted lettuce with a scoop of cottage cheese that had a little cherry on top, or maybe if you were lucky, a pear half. You get the picture? So I'm watching Harry thinking if lightning came in through the town diner, struck him dead, and he was flopping on the floor in convulsions, and they were trying to revive him, I would slide over his hamburger French fries, inherit that, eat it, put the check on his chest, and walk out the door. That's Harry. Harry is one of those people where the nature of the person and the biology is not prone to experiencing a line of cocaine or a drink or a relationship the way someone who has the addictive personality gene or biology. I can't explain it better than that. And basically, what would happen to someone like myself is instead of biologically speaking, you can see this, by the way, in, now with functional MRI technology and PET scans. Harry would eat, let's say, an ice cream cone. He would get a spritz of dopamine that would be like a little firecracker. I would have like an ash can or a cherry bomb. He would go boom, I would go kaboom. Got it? So subjectively, whether that's learning biology doesn't matter. Subjectively, what's happening is the experience of doing something that's mood or mind altering is much different for an addict than a non-addict. How much of that is inherited? How much of that is acquired or learned? How much of that is by tolerance? I can't answer that. I just know that there's a difference. So I will tell you, in the spirit of self-disclosure, I am not a Harry. And the people that I treat are not Harriets or Harrys either. So with reward circuits, you need to be aware that two things happen. One is there's something called plasticity and sensitivity. And what will happen is that someone who has the addictive component to them will be predisposed towards using, abusing, and then needing the substance or the behavior in order to either feel good or avoid feeling bad. I know I'm diverting from this, but it's the best way I can explain it. There's kind of like three chapters in this. In the first chapter, the ice cream cone, use that as an example, feels great. It works. The drink, when you're first drinking, feels great. You can dance like John Travolta. So you think people are calling 911, thinking you're having a convulsion, but you think you're doing fine. So we all know that addictive substances or behavior in the beginning, in the first chapter, they work terrific. They are. You found your Burger King having it your way. Second chapter, you're always chasing the first. It still feels okay, but not as great. You'll never get to where you wanted to go, but you're always trying. Some consequences or whatnot, maybe with the eating disorder, you're losing too much weight, you're gaining weight, or you're having physical symptoms, but nothing catastrophic. Third chapter is really sad. That's when you don't like how you feel with the behavior or substance, and you can't stand how you feel without it. Third chapter is where you're constantly trying to avoid withdrawal. But there are three chapters in recovery, which is the good news. In the first chapter, it's really hard and difficult and uncomfortable, what I call legitimate suffering. Second chapter, it gets easier, but if you had your druthers, you wouldn't want to be going through it. Third chapter, you're much more comfortable with doing recovery than in the absence of those behaviors. So kind of works like that. So anyway, the reward circuits are a biological explanation of all of this. And what we know, and I'll show you in the slides a little bit later, is that that basically it doesn't change. In other words, if you take someone that is an alcoholic, a food addict, bulimic, anorectic, compulsive overeater, they may get into recovery by abstaining from the substance or the behavior, but there's something called plasticity. So the best way I can explain neuroplasticity is if you've ridden a bicycle when you were a kid but haven't ridden in 20 years, there's muscle memory. So when you get back on a bike, it's as if in 10 minutes or a day or maybe even 2 days, it's as if you never stopped riding the bike. Well, good or bad, that's exactly what's happening in your brain. There are connections between something called the amygdala, the nucleus accumbens, the reward center, and the prefrontal cortex. You don't have to remember all this, but basically, that wiring system, even though you unplugged it, is still alive and well. So when you pick up the ice cream cone, or you pick up the drink, or you pick up the line of cocaine, or you pick up the behavior, you're back to square one. It's not in your head. Well, it is in your head, but it's not in your thinking only. So I'll get back to that. I know I'm laboring on this, but it's important. Serotonin is where the new research is coming from. Serotonin is not getting you high, not usually. Serotonin is what modulates your mood so that you feel normal. Lacking serotonin or its reuptake will cause depression and anxiety. All these medications, Prozac, SSRIs, Paxil, Zoloft, and the newer ones, SNRIs, are all an attempt to keep the amount of serotonin available in the synapses. Basically, serotonin modulates mood. What the research is finding is that there's another receptor. There's an HTP1 receptor, but we're finding there's a number two receptor out there. And I know the pharmaceutical companies don't like this, but there's some, I won't go too much into this, there's some research that some of the plant medicines can have an effect on a reset with those receptors and can have a significant effect on depression without having to take the medication for months, years, or a lifetime. So I won't get too far into that. But serotonin is a mood modulator. So I want you to think about this. Suppose you're an adolescent and you're depressed, and you find that after you've lost a few pounds, you don't feel as depressed. And then what's also happening as a result of restricting or overeating, because both would do the same thing, you're increasing a little bit of the serotonin level. In other words, you're feeling less depressed, biologically and psychologically. Can that become addictive? Absolutely. So what ends up happening to someone is that they find that their eating disorder or their chemical dependency, if you want to look at it that way, becomes an antidepressant. Of course, they build tolerance and it doesn't work anymore, but by that time, they're 6 feet under. So serotonin is another avenue, and it's why a lot of people prescribe SSRIs to people with eating disorders and addiction. But it's not a magic bullet the way it's promoted. It can be a tool. Classical conditioning. You all know about Pavlov's dog? The bell rings, the dog salivates, eats whatever. Do you think that could exist with addictions and with food addiction or compulsive overeating or whatever? How many of you are ex-smokers? Every time the phone rang, did you pick up a cigarette? There's the bell. Okay. There are literally hundreds of them. I'll give you a little vignette of how this would work. If I was a compulsive overeater as a child, symptom might have been obesity, doesn't matter. And the movie theater, going to the movies, of course now you see like a Reese's peanut butter cup playing a trumpet, rocking, you know, whatever. If you're a Harry, not a big deal. If you're not a Harry, that's a big deal. So can you get hooked into conditioning, right? That when you're in a movie theater, you associate the movie theater with dumping insulin because there is a physical response to it and ending up eating when you're not hungry? Yeah, there are hundreds of triggers. People like Harry do have triggers, but they have enough leptin and enough going on that they may eat out of appetite, but they know when to stop. If you have a broken mechanism, remember these two things combining, once you start, you're gonna have a trouble stopping. So there are hundreds of classical conditioning paradigms that can exist with all of this. External versus internal cues. Let me use Harry again, poor Harry. By the way, Harry's in Boston. He's bald, overweight, has a bad marriage, anyway. No, I'm working on it. It's another fellowship. All right. Anyway, so internal, external cues. I think this is fascinating. Internal cues mean like the ghrelin, feeling your stomach grumble, low blood sugar. You all know what it feels like to feel hungry, right? Those are internal cues. External cues are like time of day, sight of food, smell of food. Those are those triggers that are external to you. There's one exception to that that falls under the external, at least in the research, and that's emotions. That's an associated or classical condition. For instance, I grew up, my mother would say, I'm too nervous or too angry to eat. I would be thinking, I'm too nervous or too angry not to eat. So, you know, you can kind of have the external trump, the internal cues. Harry is governed, maybe 70% internal cues and 30% external cues. So he can do what's called hedonic eating because it's good dessert. He's the guy that takes a bite of the pie and pushes it aside and said, I'm full, right? And the Harry, anti-Harry, would be looking through the garbage on the pizza crust. Anyway, so I forgot where I was. I was just thinking about Harry and the pie. Anyway, so if you have an eating disorder, even anorexia, your ability to sense and be governed by internal cues is compromised. You have what I call broken thermostat. So you're externally governed. You need to know that. Why is that important? Because if you're externally oriented, you don't want to be, you know, there's a saying, you know, if you have a thought, invite it in for tea, but don't invite it for dinner. Well, you don't want to pull up a chaise lounge at the mall in front of Mrs. Fields. Smell, sight, all of that, it'll trigger a whole bunch of physical responses, dumping insulin. It will make you physically, internally hungry, as well as psychologically, you know, overwhelmed. A Harry won't have to deal with that as much. So external cues govern more the eating disorder realm, than the non-eating disorder realm. How does that work with anorexia? Well, with anorexia, it's a little bit different, but not really. In anorexia, the dopamine spurt, the serotonin modulation, and the external orientation manifests itself with starvation or restricting or purging, meaning that for someone, if you've ever fasted, what'll end up happening is you can get addicted to feeling better by not eating. So what ends up happening is you can get a dopamine spurt by fasting after a while. And what happens with someone who's anorectic is that, like the compulsive overeater, they become dependent on the not eating as a way to avoid feeling depressed. And when they eat, or when someone like that will eat, they'll feel anxious and depressed, whereas when someone else with a compulsive overeating pattern, they will feel better when they're overeating. So one is called negative reinforcement, where they're avoiding pain by eating, and the other is positive reinforcement, which becomes negative reinforcement, by overeating. I'll tell you a quick study, and hopefully you won't be falling asleep with this, but there's a fellow by the name of Walter Kay. He's out at UCLA in San Diego. He's a premier researcher and a good guy, by the way. He took, in his eating disorder unit, quick aside, about 50 patients that were anorectic, restricting, and what they call purging anorectic. It really doesn't matter. They were significantly underweight, and they were fitting the criteria for anorexia. Okay, and then he took, I used to love to do this, college volunteers. College freshmen and sophomores in psychology departments are infamous volunteers, period. Well, these volunteers got a real treat. What he did is he got the government to sanction 7% solution in catheters that he injected or used of cocaine. And he gave the cocaine to both groups, the anorectic group and the normal or college age volunteers. And they did functional MRI studies. Now, functional MRI will show you the concentration of dopamine in the brain and where it is and when it's, you know, going from normal state to the explosive state that we talked about. Okay. So he compared the MRIs between both groups. Guess what? They were identical. Both groups had the same explosive dopamine picture on the MRI. You couldn't delineate between them. This is what's fascinating to me. The group that were anorectic, about 8 out of 10, described the experience as horrible, anxiety-producing, aversive. They wanted no part of it. The opposite happened with the control group. They all loved it. They couldn't wait for the next experiment. They all got high. You can't explain that biologically. They were identical. The only way to explain it is, or one of the ways to explain it is, that there's something with the restricting end that experiences the dopamine from eating as anxiety provoking. Now, I don't know if this will make sense to anybody in here, so this is part research, part personal, whatever, but there's a contingent of people in the world who don't smoke pot or marijuana because it makes them anxious. And there's another group of people that'll tell you they smoke pot because it relaxes them. There's something either in the chemistry or the learning history that accounts for that. My guess is that people that tend to be more on the compulsive side and maybe have had some trauma or some ingredients with all that experience the dopamine, feeling good to us, as aversive. Am I explaining this right? Can you all follow? You want to say something?
No, I'm curious. Is this more, it's a question. Is this mostly driven by the emotional side, or is it mostly driven by the, because it's a lack of control for a lot of
them? Yeah. It's a great question. Remember what I said. There's a blending of emotional components and biological components. My guess is that no one knows for sure. There's probably a learning history or a trauma history. And remember, whatever happens emotionally has a corollary biologically. If I took out a blank gun and you weren't expecting it and I fired it in the air, everybody here would have a physiological reaction. You'd turn white, your blood, fight or flight. you would be dumping, you know, from your adrenal glands, adrenaline, you'd be dumping cortisol, all this stuff would be happening. So sometimes people get stuck, like a gear getting stuck, maybe with trauma or, I don't know. Yeah, right. So there's a interplay between the neurochemistry or the neuroplasticity and learning history, classical conditioning, and all of that stuff. Remember what I said, so what, now what? So what, now what? So the issue when we get to part two, which is the solution, this would take 6 days. Do you all bring sleeping bags? Okay, anyway. So I just want to give you an appreciation for how complicated this can be. Now, if you go over to the binge eating or the binging and purging end of this, or compulsive overeating end of this, it's a similar mechanism, but it's a different experience. So for the compulsive overeater, eating becomes an antidepressant. For the anorectic, not eating becomes an antidepressant. Both are headed for a train wreck because they get to chapter three, because eventually it doesn't work anymore. All addictions have that in common, right? You get to a point that no matter what you're doing, it ain't working anymore. And so the lethal dose with some drugs starts to catch up with the tolerance and you're in trouble. All right. I'm sorry I'm getting stuck on all this, but I am. Hormonal, we talked about ghrelin, leptin. Insulin's very interesting. By the way, my experience when I see compulsive overeaters, binge eaters, and some bulimics, and they come in with, when you get to your 30s or 40s, you will develop type 2 diabetes because you'll end up with insulin resistance. So it's very common to see type 2 diabetes in treatment. I would say 3/4 are reversible within 6 to 8 weeks. Off of insulin, whether it's injectable or it's a metformin or medication or whatever, because what you're doing is you're reversing insulin resistance by putting them on a low glycemic or diabetic food plan, which is basically sugar-free, flour-free, and something that I'll talk about a little bit in part two. No one's going to the bathroom, we're going to pass out catheters. No, just kidding. We're going to talk about SMURF. That's the formula, SMURF. It's an acronym. My own invention, you could throw apples at me, or tomatoes. Spirituality, meditation, exercise, rest, and food are the ingredients to resolving 90% of what ails us, but particularly with addictions. But I'll get to that. Okay, so hormonal, I just want to give you an appreciation. There's a lot of chemistry. Hormonal are basically the chemicals that notify the brain to enact certain functions. I'll just leave it at that. Emotional, we talked about. This is real important, processed foods. The more processed the substance is, whether it's a food or a drug, the more addictive it is. The more processed something is, the more addictive it is. Cocaine. The Indians in Peru chew coca leaves. Not a lot of addiction. I don't think you see a lot of people here with coca leaf addiction. But you process that, you get a powder or a paste, you get cocaine. That's pretty addictive. You further process that, you get rock cocaine. And so it goes. You could take any substance, poppy seeds and opium, and refine it or get a prologue or prodrug or analog to it, and you get fentanyl. So the more you process, the more addictive something is. In this country, if you looked at a chart, what you would see that since 1970 in the introduction of high fructose corn syrup, which is much cheaper than cane sugar, the incidence of heart disease, diabetes, obesity, the things that they list, skyrocketed. How about diabetes with kids under 12? Skyrocketed. Sugar is much more addictive than cocaine. Sugar is much more addictive than cocaine. That's a fact.
Why are processed substances more addictive as opposed to substances that are not processed?
Sure.
Yeah, it's a worthy question. The reason is it's such a concentration of the substance that instead of getting like a little spritz, you're getting an atom bomb. So, you know, it's like fentanyl, sufentanyl. I mean, you can keep going and going and going. And with sugar, it got so processed that it was put in everything, spaghetti sauce, everything. It's an additive in everything. If it's the fifth ingredient or less or more, you're probably safe, but you cannot go a day without ingesting cane sugar. By the way, 300 years ago, it didn't exist. It was brought to this country through the West Indies. It was considered a spice. So this business about refined, you know, about raw sugar and all this other stuff, it's baloney. It has 50,000 different names. They've disguised it as dextrose, sucrose, this dose, this one. Just take my word for it. So I'm going to give me 5 minutes, and then you can all go to the bathroom. So plasticity, we talked about switching. Big thing here is 90% of the people that we see, maybe that's a little exaggeration, maybe it's 75%, have come to us after they started to get in recovery from alcohol or drug addiction. Why? Because addictions are all the same neural pathways. To me, there's not a difference between an alcoholic and a drug addict. The nature of the substance may be different, and how you treat it medically might be a little different, but the mechanism, same. Same with process addictions, all the same neural pathways. So what ends up happening is there's kind of like this triangle, the way I look at it. You can start out with alcohol and drugs, but you're going to pick up another one that's going to take center stage. You put down one, it's, what's that, whack-a-mo? That's what addictions are. The way I visualize it is switching chairs on the Titanic thinking you're not going to drown. So recovery is a process that takes one after the other after the other. It's ongoing with all of that. The other thing I wanted to say is cortisol, stress hormone. When you secrete cortisol, forgetting about all the deleterious effects, it'll make you ravenous. When you're stressed, biologically speaking, unless you've learned differently, cortisol will excite you to want to eat. And trauma, we could talk for days about trauma. There's an area of the brain called the amygdala. Trauma does not lend itself towards cognitive process therapy so much as it's stored in a neural pathway in an area of the brain that you need to access through a back door, EMDR. And now they're starting to use MDMA for trauma treatment. It's a whole new area of research, which is ecstasy, but used medicinally. That's in stage 3 clinical trials, by the way, at Johns Hopkins. Shows a lot of promise. Psilocybin, I can go on and on and on with all that, but that's controversial. Okay, so trauma is the other one. So let me speed this up, and then we'll take a break. This is my friend from the research, Herman. He's eating a Hershey bar. Yeah, right? We didn't sacrifice him. He's fine. He's retired. He's living in a nice place. I hope this experiment never ends, blah, blah, blah. Let's see if we can get this to work.
And a headline tonight rocketing around all day, a closer look at Oreo cookies and a new study tonight that suggests if you can't stop eating them, there's a reason. Nightline anchor Dan Harris.
If you too crave Oreo cookies, you're in good company. We all have our little strategies, of course. Twist them apart, eat the filling first, dip them in milk. But feed them to rats, then things get interesting. That's what researchers at Connecticut College did, and they found that when eating Oreos, the pleasure centers in the little guy's brains lit up as much or even more than on cocaine. And yes, by the way, the rats ate the filling first. Now, to be clear, this study has not been peer-reviewed or published. And as Nabisco, the maker of Oreos, said today, quote, "While it may seem simple to bucket foods as good or bad, the reality is that foods are complex, and encouraging people to enjoy a balanced diet paired with physical activity is most important." True, many experts say the way to fight obesity is more exercise, more fruits and vegetables, and when it comes to things like cookies, moderation. Although, as any lab rat will tell you, that last part is not always easy. Dan Harris, ABC News, New York.
So just so you know, it has been peer-reviewed and replicated a number of times. That's a couple of years old. So this is what I just want to say about the processing. Cocoa leaf, poppy plants, tobacco, sugar cane. the bliss foods, by the way, food industry does it is they find out where the perfect balance between salt, sugar, and flour is. And that's how they sell their snack foods. So reward circuitry, prefrontal cortex, that's the area that's reasoning, that makes us intelligent and whatnot. The area that's called the nucleus accumbens, that's the central area where we experience reward, where all those receptors are. And the amygdala is where we store trauma or experiences or events. Although we don't have memory direct access to them, there's still a neurological trigger that'll exist. So we get into a whole thing with trauma, but really the root of the trauma and the way to get to trauma is not through the prefrontal cortex, which is the Mr. Spock area. That's the area that we talk about how our mother abused us kind of a thing, as opposed to being triggered and then dealing with stuff that's happening in the amygdala area. So, hedonic eating we talked about. Just one last thing. Sight of food, external cues. On your left is a control subject. That would be a Harry. If I was showing Harry slides of cheesecakes and appetizing foods or whatever, or exposing him to smells or any of the senses, the external cues, his area of dopamine concentration would be very little, normative response. If you took a non-Harry, that's binge eating disorder, you can see the difference. That's a functional MRI slide. So the technology's caught up with theory. You can actually see this stuff. Neuroplasticity we talked about, sensitization we talked about. If you have one addiction, you're prone to another. The most common addiction that I see with compulsive overeaters is to cocaine. And the other thing I just tell you, to give you some backwards evidence, is people that have had gastric sleeve or gastric bypass, they'll do well for a year to 18 months. A high percentage of them, meaning over 40%, develop late onset alcohol dependency or another addiction. Nature of the person, you can't just fix somebody by fixing their anatomy. This is an interesting slide, just to drive home a point. On the right, is somebody, and if you fed them a milkshake and a functional MRI, that's where they would light up in terms of that dopamine spritz. This is someone who was abstinent from sugar and flour and following recovery, who volunteered. It was on ABC a couple of years ago. But anyway, they injected her with a sugar solution, and this is what happened to her brain. So you can go 10 years without a drink or without, you know, a drug, and the first time you do it, even though you've lowered your tolerance, you're back to square one. You've gotten back on the bicycle. It doesn't take very long. American Society of Addiction Medicine, this is the best definitions I've heard of for addiction across the board. Primary chronic disease of brain reward, motivation, memory, and related circuitry. We talked about brain circuitry and neurochemistry. Dysfunction in these circuits leads to characteristic biological, psychological, social, and spiritual manifestations. We'll get into talking about that. This is reflecting the individual pursuing reward and or relief by substance use or other behaviors. This is the one that I have every patient I treat really understand. Addiction is characterized by impairment in biological, behavioral control, craving, inability to consistently abstain, and diminished recognition, denial, of significant problems with one's behaviors and interpersonal relationships. This is important. Like other chronic diseases, addiction involves cycles of relapse and remission. Cycles of relapse and remission. Get rid of the shame piece to relapse. Without treatment or engagement and recovery activities, addiction is progressive and can result in disability or death. Quick word from our sponsors, if you didn't believe me, in 2015, the Academy of Pediatrics, Cardiology, American Academy of Family Physicians, blah, 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 were all giving humongous donations by the sugar industry. And a matter of fact, the American Dietetic Association, where's my dietitian? Hello. The organization primary sponsor in their annual convention was McDonald's. now you're seeing ads about, you know, Pepsi and Coke, lower portions, less sugar and all that. Yeah, okay. So just saying, New York Times database, 120 million. And they're also, when you look at the internet, be careful of where the research was sponsored, because the research that's saying there's no proof of sugar being toxic or addictive is the same protocol as was used by the tobacco industry. Remember doctors prescribing cigarettes? So, all right, we'll pick up on this. Thank you very much for your attention. We'll cover 5 minutes. Okay. Okay, so look, this is an awful lot of information, I realize, just to kind of give you an appreciation for all this. But I'm going to tell you something as a psychologist and a neuropsychologist. 99% of what we hear in a therapy session or we read in a book or we hear in a workshop like this will be forgotten within an hour. It's impossible to remember all this. The exception is that what we remember usually either has to have an experience associated with it, a doing associated with it, or an emotion associated with it. Everybody in this room probably remembers where they were, what they were doing when they first saw or heard about 9/11, because there's an emotion attached to it. Everybody here remembers their first kiss. You also remember things that you have some action with. So for instance, in our treatment center, it's all in vivo. So although we have a lot of structure and support, people go grocery shopping, they prepare meals, they go to meetings. The last day they're in treatment and the next day when they go home should be pretty much the same. The reason for that is the experience is what they'll remember. They're not going to remember what they had in therapy group. I mean, I'd like to say I'm this brilliant therapist and, you know, and people will remember what pearls of wisdom I've imparted to them. That's BS. I think our jobs are to get people, perhaps, to have an experience or an emotion attached to something that we would like to see them be able to take away when they leave. So I just want to add that on. So what we're going to do, which is I think is the more important part of this, and that thing is always taunting me. Anyway, let's talk about the solution. So what, now what? So I want to talk about the now what. All right, so I thought what I would do is give you some taste of all of this. So this is kind of like the before recovery. This is how I see people when they come into treatment. However, this is how they leave. Now, if you'll indulge me, I want to show you the... Anybody here work in managed care? Whew. Okay. This is the managed care version of what therapy is for eating disorders, addictions, and issues in general. So it's about 6 minutes long, so bear with it. But this will give you a hands-on idea, so you can walk away with it, of how to fix people that you work with. Actually, it's my fantasy of doing sessions.
Dr. Switzer?
Yes, come in. I'm just washing my hands.
I'm Catherine Bigman. Janet Carlisle referred me.
Oh, yes. Feel being buried alive in a box.
Yes. Yes, that's me. Should I lay down?
Oh, no. We don't do that anymore. Just have a seat. And let me tell you a bit about our billing. I charge $5 for the first 5 minutes. And then absolutely nothing after that. How does that sound?
That sounds great. Too good to be true, as a matter of fact.
Well, I can almost guarantee you that our session won't last the full 5 minutes. Now, we don't do any insurance billing, so you would either have to pay in cash or by check.
Wow, okay.
And I don't make change.
All right.
And go.
Go.
Well, tell me about the problem that you wish to address.
Oh, okay. Well, I have this fear of being buried alive in a box. I start thinking about being buried alive and I begin to panic.
Has anyone ever tried to bury you alive in a box?
No, but truly thinking about it does make my life horrible. I mean, I can't go through tunnels or be in an elevator or in a house, anything boxy.
So what you're saying is you're claustrophobic.
Yes, that's it.
All right, well, let's go, Catherine. I'm going to say two words to you right now. I want you to listen to them very, very carefully. Then I want you to take them out of the office with you and incorporate them into your life.
Well, shall I write them down?
Well, if it makes you comfortable, it's just two words. We find most people can remember them.
Okay.
You ready?
Yes.
Okay, here they are. Stop it!
I'm sorry?
Stop it!
Stop it?
Yes, S-T-O-P, new word, I-T.
So, what are you saying?
You know, it's funny. I say two simple words, and I cannot tell you the amount of people who say exactly the same thing you're saying. I mean, this is not Yiddish, Catherine. This is English. Stop it!
So, I should just stop it.
There you go. I mean, you don't want to go through life being scared of being buried alive in a box, do you? I mean, that sounds frightening.
Yes.
Then stop it!
I can't. I mean, it's been with me since childhood.
No, no, we don't go there. Just stop it.
So I should just stop being afraid of being buried alive in a box.
You got it. Good go. Well, it's only been 3 minutes, so that will be $3.
I only have a five, so.
Well, I don't make change.
Then I guess I'll take the full 5 minutes.
Fine. All right. Well, what other problems would you like to address?
I'm bulimic. I stick my fingers down my throat.
Stop it! What are you, a nut of some kind? Don't do that.
But I'm compelled to. My mom used to call me fatty.
No. No, we don't go there.
But I've been having this dream.
No, we don't go there either.
But my horoscope did say...
We definitely don't go there. Just stop it. What else?
Well, I have self-destructive relationships with men.
Stop it! You want to be with a man, don't you?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm, yes.
Well, then stop it. Don't be such a big baby.
I wash my hands a lot.
That's all right.
It is?
I wash my hands all the time. There's a lot of germs out there. Uh-huh. Yeah, don't worry about that one.
I'm afraid to drive.
Well, stop it! How are you going to get around? Get in the car and drive, you kook!
Stop it! You stop it! You stop it!
What's the problem, Kathy?
I don't like this. I don't like this therapy at all. You're just telling me to stop it.
And you don't like that?
No, I don't.
So you think we're moving too fast. Is that it?
Yes. Yes, I do.
All right, then let me give you 10 words that I think will clear everything up for you. You want to get a pad and a pencil for this one?
All right.
Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
All right, here are the 10 words. Stop it or I'll bury you alive in a box!
Okay, so let's talk about tenets of recovery. So the first, and again, this could apply to any addiction, but we're just going to be talking about compulsive overeating, food addiction, binge eating disorder, bulimia, and in some instances, anorexia. So the need to identify and abstain from the addictive substances. We start out kind of with these boundaries. No sugar, fifth ingredient if they're shopping. No flour, and weighing and measuring. So the three criteria that we're really looking at is volume, because you can overdose on diet food. Anybody here ever get like Weight Watchers frozen foods and eat six of them? Anyway. Need to address the mood or psychological issues contributing to maintaining the addictive behavior. Basically, when I say addressing, I don't mean just providing insight. I mean, I may know that I was a compulsive overeating at 9, and then I went to an analyst, and the analyst figured out that my mother only breastfed me on her left breast, never allowed me to feed on her right breast, and now I'm binging on turkey breast. That may all be true, but it don't matter. So what, now what? What does matter is how am I going to cope with emotions without fixing them through a substance or behavior? So that's what I mean by that. Need to address the physical issues. Look, we see people that their ADLs, activities of daily living, are compromised because of the symptom of obesity. We do see people that with diabetes, stress-related disorders, PTSD, et cetera, so on the physical side, you need to address some of those issues. So there's a medical component to looking at this, doing labs and kind of addressing those issues as well that are ancillary to the eating disorder. And this is the big one, eliminating isolation. In my experience personally and professionally, almost without exception, people with addictions or substance use disorders and some process addictions tend to isolate at the end stage of their addiction. And that part of the therapeutic value of 12-step programs and or other support groups and or therapeutic communities and or treatment is the fact that you're almost forced to interact and not isolate. I think one of the biggest factors in healing is community. And this gets into the spirituality realm, but I'm just going to make it simple. How many of you have heard of Brené Brown? She has a great definition for spirituality. I like it. Her definition of spirituality is basically the recognition of how we're all inextricably connected. In other words, the more you can dissolve the ego and see yourself in other people, the closer you are to whatever your form of a higher being is. That doesn't mean that religion can't be a part of spirituality. It's just that spirituality has its own kind of flavoring to it. So I think there's great value in community-based support groups and in community at large. Okay, this gets into the formula. So over the years, look, for me, remember what I said about memory? I'm not going to remember much unless there's an experience or an emotion attached to something. Also, there's associative learning. So I don't know about you guys, but a lot of things, anachronisms we'll remember. HALT, hungry, angry, lonely, tired, if you're in a 12-step fellowship. So one that I've kind of like distilled over the years that works for me personally, but also for most of my patients, I've labeled as SMURF. And I don't know if it was last year or 2 years ago, whatever, I did a talk on meditation, because I really think that that's a very important component in recovery at large. But anyway, the SMRF, the spirituality, the meditation, the exercise, the rest, and the food plan, let me explain it to you because there's more than meets the eye with it. Spirituality is the most ambiguous term of all of these, and it's purposely so because it's so personal. So spirituality for me might be something completely different than it is for you. So I'm giving the most global definition, but basically it's the belief in something other than just relying on your own ego or self. So whether you call it a higher power, a God of your understanding, or whatever you want to do, the more important point is the doing and cultivating it. So the question I ask patients and myself is, the key word is doing. What am I doing on that plane, on spirituality? What am I doing on exercise? What am I doing on rest? What am I doing on the food plan and exercise? So it's the doing part. So you can list a whole bunch of stuff that has to do with spirituality. I'm going to tell you, I'm going to pass or give you these cards if you want them. But there's someone who came up with four questions, not to be confused with Passover's four questions. But they're inventories for a 10th, 11th, and 12th step in 12-step programs. But you don't have to be in a 12-step program to use them. His name is Eddie. He's 92 years old. He's been in recovery almost 50 years, and we call him Four Question Eddie. But it's one of those things that I find really helps people if they want to connect on a spiritual level. So you can use it or discard it, but it's on a card that you're welcome to have. And what it is the four questions that you would ask yourself at night. The first is, what did I do today that I like and respect myself for? What did I do today that I like and respect myself for? The second question is, what did I do for someone else today without expecting something back? The third question is kind of interesting. What did I see today that had nothing to do with me that I really liked? If you wanted to get spiritual about it, it's thinking about, what did I see today that reminded me of God's love or spirituality or whatever. But the simple question is, what did I see today that I really liked that had nothing to do with me? And the other one, okay, I'm just giving you a message here. We want from me. Damn. Oops, sorry. Where was I? The other one is, I call the Eckhart Tolle question. What problems do I have today? What problems do I have today? So those are four questions that can fall under the category of, what did you do spiritually? It could be going to a meeting, going to church. It could be a ritual involved with your religion. It could be whatever you want it to be, but it's a doing thing, not a feeling thing. The feelings come after the doing. The meditation, I'm just going to make it very simple. Meditation has so many different meanings from different people. It can mean contemplation. It can mean, focused breathing. It can mean keeping it very simple. Meditation means taking a period of time, getting quiet, and then involved in a practice where you're, for instance, focusing on breathing, but becoming aware of how often your mind leaves the station and becoming aware of bringing it back to the station. The way the mind works is it can't rest. And so as physical exercise is for the body, meditation is for training the mind. So the issue is not to control your thinking, because that's impossible. The issue is to learn not to be controlled by it. So one of my favorite expressions is, don't believe everything you tell yourself. So the meditation, I'll be very honest with you. When I started trying to do this on a personal level, I couldn't sit still for 3 minutes. I can honestly tell you I do 35 minutes a day and haven't missed a day in over a year. Remember what I said about the three chapters? First is discipline in recovery. The second, it's a little inconvenient, but I'll do it. The third is, you're much more comfortable doing it and much more uncomfortable in its absence. Call it habit, call it what you want. I won't go into the benefits of it, but I will tell you that what'll happen is you become aware of the themes in your ruminations. In my experience with human beings, this is oversimplification, there are three major divisions. It's not just true of people with addiction, it's money, power, and sex. Not literally, but along those themes. And what you'll find is that if you're meditating and trying to focus on your breathing, let's say, and then you catch the train, meaning that your mind's been hijacked into this area, you become aware of what these themes are, and you can bring the train back, or you can, I don't know how this happens, cultivate some insights into really knowing yourself. It's something I can't explain because it's an experience, and you can't understand an experience until you have it. You know that Buddhist expression? I can give you something to read, you'll forget it. I can show you something, you might remember it, but if you do it, you really understand it. So the meditation, I can't tell you how important enough it is. The exercise is real interesting. You don't see this a lot in recovery literature, but I think exercise is kind of a missing piece to this. I don't mean Lance Armstrong biking. I don't mean working out in a medieval Dark Ages torture device room called 24-Hour Fitness. Isn't that medieval? I mean, if you think about the stress. So anyway, I'm talking about doing for your body what's healthy. It could be walking for some of you. It could be jogging. It could be biking. It could be whatever you want it to be, but it's moving large muscles. Just like spirituality, it's individualized. But it's something you do on a regular or daily basis. It can be as simple as walking for 20 minutes. By the way, they all bleed into each other because you can meditate and walk at the same time. Spirituality could be a part of that. They all blend into each other. The rest is very important. The rest, at least for our patients, and myself, and probably for all of us, is a balance between work and play. Rest doesn't only mean sleeping 8 hours, because if you have insomnia, you're not going to will yourself or control sleeping for 8 hours, although that would be nice. But providing enough time for you to sleep, that would be good. But also the balance between the work and play is most people with addictions and eating disorders being one of them, are all or none, feast or famine, black and white. There are two speeds, all out or comatose. And rest is finding a middle ground. I've added something to that. It's a balance between work, play, and self-care. The self-care could be getting a massage every week. It could be hygiene related. It could be anything that embellishes your, remember that first question? What did I do today that results in my liking and respecting myself kind of a thing? They all blend together, but rest is balance. I don't know how many of you can identify with this, but going through stages where you're all work and no play, or you're all play and all work, you know, or you're not taking care of yourself because your codependency is taking care of everybody else, and on and on and on. So that's that piece. The food plan will vary from person to person, but it's a plan. Here's how I look at it. You can leave it or you can use it. You don't have to have an eating disorder to use this. A food plan means putting boundaries around my food. I don't weigh and measure what I eat. I mean, in the beginning, that can be important, but I'm not going to walk into a wedding with a, you know, those scales that look like you're dealing cocaine or something with the little metal things. You put a chicken breast on, and then you grab the champagne, which is really grape juice if you're an alcoholic, and you get up on the dais and you explain to people the virtues of eating protein and staying away from sugar. I'm not talking about that. What I'm talking about is trying to limit or abstain from unhealthy eating or unhealthy foods. So if you can do moderation and you're a Harry, that's great. I still think it does no harm to eat healthy. What does that mean? It means limiting or eliminating highly processed foods, sugar, white flour, let's just say, and keeping an eye on volume. And for me, doesn't mean this would be for you, it might mean eating 5 or 6 times a day instead of this, you know, indoctrination of 3 big meals or whatever. One of the things that I think is a blessing in recovery, starting to think out of the box. Remember, don't believe everything you tell yourself. Also, don't believe everything you're told. So that's the Smurf. There's only one other thing I would say, and that is that you're not going to remember Smurf, per se. There are these cards, that so when you leave here today, on one side, it's those four questions, and on the other side, it's Smurf, what it stands for. But I also took the liberty of getting Smurfs. So so I'm going to leave them up here, and you could take them with you. And then when you look at it, if you put it somewhere, it'll remind you by association of what Smurf means. Now, I'll tell you this, and this is a little bit more self-disclosure, but I don't think it's a stretch to look at, and that is that I find it helpful whether you're in recovery, not in recovery. All of us can use something in recovery, because if you're not in recovery, then you have someone that you wish was in recovery, or you know someone or whatever. I think all people would benefit from the four questions and the Smurf. If someone came into an office and I was an internist and they had type 2 diabetes, I would give them the same formulas I would give them if they had an eating disorder. So there's nothing about what you're hearing here that you wouldn't benefit from. One of the things that I find helpful is the concept of an inventory that you could do at night or in the morning. And the inventory is those four questions and the Smurf. What did I do? Checklist. Spirituality. What did I do? Meditation. What did I do? Exercise. What did I do for rest? And what did I do for a food plan? I'm going to tell you something. For the people that I work with and myself, because we're all the same, when something is off, I'm not feeling right, it means there's usually something in one of those areas that's off. So if I'm finding it very difficult, or you're finding it, or a patient is finding it very difficult to identify what's going on, the first place to look might be this Smurf thing. Well, are you going to meetings? Are you connecting with a higher power? Are you relying on something other than yourself? You know, whatever that might be. Are you meditating or taking time, you know, along those lines? Are you exercising? Are you getting enough rest? And how are you eating? 9 times out of 10, something's off in that area. Then the other area on the S is those four questions. It works. The simpler you keep this for people that you're working with or yourself, the greater the probability it'll have a utility. But it's just conversation will be forgotten an hour after you leave here unless you're putting into practice. So the whole concept, I think, in treating eating disorders is about see one, do one, teach one. It's really about what I would call, from my academic background, in vivo. In vivo means in life. In vitro means in the laboratory. Anybody can be put in a container for 28 days and not drink, drug, overeat, be forced to eat or whatever. What you'll do is you'll treat a symptom for a while, but then it will reemerge or come out in another direction. If we teach each other a different lifestyle or altering course, that has some permanence to it. Okay? So, we have a few more minutes. Let me just go through this, and then we can kind of like open it up to some questions. Let's see what else I had here. Yeah, this is just to give you a flavor of what we do in treatment. It's not a commercial, just what I happen to do. But we do a structured food plan. And the reason for that, remember I talked about Harry, internal versus external cues? Well, if you have a broken thermostat, you're not going to do intuitive eating. Or if you try to do intuitive eating, you're going to end up doing intuitive eating disorder. So we structure a food plan, meaning we ask people to eat within, you know, some flexibility certain times of the day. So morning, mid-morning, afternoon, mid-afternoon, evening, snack, that kind of thing. We do cognitive behavioral and DBT, which really equals harm reduction. We're teaching living skills. I won't go into constructive living, but the issue is that feelings aren't the holy grail. What you do is more important than what you think or feel, but what you do will influence how you think and feel. Real world setting we talked about, medication when needed, evidence-based treatments, individual family therapy, all that good stuff. talked about the food plan. Dialectical absence is a nice, complicated way of saying that no one's perfect. So you want to have some flexibility, but you don't want to cut corners till you run out of paper. So you don't want to rationalize your way into relapse with the eating disorder. So look, everything we've talked about here, or most of it, is in a book that I wrote. I don't lug around copies of the book. It's free. If you go to the website, you can ask for the electronic copy and get it. It's totally free. And it'll contain pretty much what we talked about here. If you have any questions or want to get in touch with me, that's the way to do that. Any comments or thoughts regarding any of this? I'd entertain it.
Yeah,
sure.
Could you repeat those four items that you had mentioned?
The questions? The SMERP? Oh, the SMERP is five.
Well, but the other
which
four.
One did you forget?
Four.
Four questions are, what did I do today? It'll be on that card. What did I do today? Yeah, I'll give you one. What did I do today that I like and respect myself for? What did I do for someone else today? What did I see that I really liked that had nothing to do with me? And what problems do I have today? Any other comments, questions?
So if you're not just working on the eating disorder, if they have real issues with codependency, and the facility capable of working through that?
Yeah, it's when you say working through, here's the deal. When someone comes into a residential level of care, the realities today is they're not staying like in the 80s extended care for 6 months, although some do. But if someone's there for 30 days, realistically, it's like an emergency room. You want to get them stable with their disordered eating. You want to identify what they need to work on, you know, when they leave. Codependency, which is about control and trust and issues with relationships, certainly could be identified. But we're not going to do heavy, intensive trauma work or codependency work or, you know, we can start those things, but each individual a little different. When someone's there, you know, 12 weeks or longer, yes. What we do is usually someone 6 weeks residential, then they can stay at our facility or they can do something outside like an Airbnb and they go PHP or day treatment, then IOP, and so they transition out. 75% of the people we see come from out of state or out of area. And some who are under 30 need what I call a parentectomy. So they relocate or whatever. So everybody's a little bit different, but yeah, it's an interesting model.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So about the title of today's talk, food addiction, eating disorder, or substance abuse disorder, was the answer that it's both? Or, I mean, like, I...
Yeah, here's my answer. My answer is it is both. It really is for a good percentage of people a substance use disorder. It follows that definition, but it becomes a little bit of semantics. What I would say is it's more of a substance use disorder, if this is a way to conceptualize it, than it is a psychiatric illness. For years, and still today, it's considered a mental illness, and it's really, in my mind, like addiction, is a brain disease. It's not a mental illness. There's a difference in my mind. There's a biological flavoring to it that needs to be recognized. So addiction to me is more brain disease. There are other mental illnesses that may have a biological base, like schizophrenia or bipolar or whatever, but I don't consider those addictive illnesses or substance use issues. So yes. Yeah.
Couple comments. One, the young woman I mentioned who was in this weight loss program, she had a structured program, lifted diet, a few weeks out from finishing the 16 weeks, stopped the program. I think I want her to continue beyond the 16 weeks. No rationale, no goal, no harm reduction in the process. So she went out and bought a bag of Oreos,
sure.
a bag of chips, a bunch of gummies.
Yeah. Look, there is no quick fix to an addiction. There's no magic pill. There's no surgical procedure. There's no magic elixir. I will tell you that the research now is leaning towards combining things and looking out of the box in treating this. But in my experience, whatever you're doing needs to be combined with a lifestyle support system. You need a blueprint. Most people, whether it's an eating disorder, drug addiction, or alcoholism, need a blueprint for living. For instance, this is an ancient quote, but most people with addictions don't know how to form a partnership with another person, how to be in a relationship. So I think part of recovery, when you get beyond the substance and you get beyond the behaviors, is learning how to be one amongst others and to have some kind of support or structure in your life so that you're not reverting back to old behavior as your default coping mechanism. So if all you change is I'm not drinking, I'm not drugging, I'm not overeating, or I'm dieting, you are just buying some time and you will relapse even worse than before. When people enter AA, they're buying some time, but if they're just doing the first step and the 12th step, they will likely relapse. So recovery isn't about losing weight. It's about changing everything. I know. Yeah. People learn or remember by experience, usually pain, unfortunately. So that's the deal. Anything else? Yeah.
Is that why you said the weight reduction curve?
Well, if you have a weight disorder, as opposed to an eating disorder, it could be a tool. However, the reality is that everybody that has an addiction is enamored with the idea that something can happen to them that'll make them thin or not want to eat. And so they don't do the work. So I'll leave you with a story, and it's a true story. When I was in my late 20s, I was interning in a hospital in New York, and the psychiatric unit was on the 17th floor. And there's a thin divide between wearing paper slippers and talking to people with paper slippers, but at that time I was talking to people with paper slippers. Anyway, the chief of psychiatry was taking us, the residents, on rounds, and one of the patients came up to him and said, he took him by the lapel in the lab coat and said, I want to know what the secret is. How come Tom's getting out of here? What did you tell him? What's the secret? What's the secret to getting better? I want to know the secret. And this guy didn't flinch. Meanwhile, I'm like, you know, soiling my pants, freaked out. And the guy's still, you know, insisting. So the chief of psychiatry says, you really want to know the secret? The guy says, yeah, I want to know the secret. How come he's getting out of here? Why won't you tell me the secret? And the chief looked at this guy square in the eye. I never forgot this, a long time ago. And say, well, I'll tell you the secret. The secret is hard work. I never forgot that because it took a long time for me to connect those dots. So when you look at gastric surgery, or you look at antidepressants, or you look at this program, or this pill, or this, you know, guru, or this sponsor, or whatever it is, whatever you grow dependent upon, you will grow to resent. And if you're not willing to endure the legitimate suffering and work to get from chapter one to chapter three, it's all an illusion. It's a tool, but unfortunately, surgeons want to cut, psychologists want to connect the dots, and no one's getting together to recognize that you need to do this as a community. And unless your treatment is encompassing the physical, the emotional, and the spiritual, you are barking up the wrong tree. I thank you very much for your attention. I hope you got something out of today.